Good afternoon. I welcome you all to the second lecture of the Professor Madhav Menon Memorial Lecture Series, which has been organized by the Akhil Bhartiya Adhivakta Parishad to commemorate the death anniversary of the legendary Professor Madhav Menon. In this series, lectures on various topics will be delivered by eminent jurists and stalwarts of our legal profession in honor and memory of Professor Madhav Menon and his immeasurable contribution to the fields of law and legal education in India. The first enriching lecture of this series on the contours of judicial review was delivered last week by our Honorable Attorney General for India, Mr. K.K. Venugopal. Today, it is our absolute privilege that for the second lecture of the series, we have with us Senior Advocate and former Attorney General for India, Mr. Mukul Rohatgi, who will be taking us through the journey of our Honorable Supreme Court from 1958 until today. With his vast experience of different branches of the law, there is no person better qualified to take us through this remarkable journey, which has shaped the history of our nation. We welcome you, sir, and thank you for sparing your valuable time to share with us your thoughts on today's topic. To deliver the welcome address today, we also have with us here Professor Krishna Swami, Vice Chancellor of National Law School, Bangalore, and one of the finest academicians and legal minds in our country. Professor Krishna Swami graduated from NLS Bangalore in 1998. And is currently the Vice Chancellor of his alma mater. Even after his graduation, he was selected by the University of Oxford to attend its prestigious BCL program on the even more prestigious Rhodes Scholarship. He thereafter went on to receive his DPhil in law from the University of Oxford in 2008. He has also been a teaching fellow at Pembroke College at Oxford University. Professor Krishna Swami has been a full-time professor at NUJS Calcutta and the Azim Premji University, Bangalore. He has also been a visiting lecturer at the University of Buckingham, University of Greenwich, Columbia Law School in New York, National Law School, Bangalore, and the Indian Institute of Foreign Trade. He has also worked in the Prime Minister's Committee on Infrastructure and the Kasturirangan Committee on the Governance of Bangalore. Today, Professor Krishna Swami is regarded one of the finest academicians of the current era. The respect and affection which his students have for him is palpable from the events of 2019, when the students of NLS Bangalore boycotted their classes in protest of the slight delay in his appointment as Vice Chancellor, a protest which was called off only when the Chief Justice of India ultimately intervened. Professor Krishna Swami has a wealth of editorial experience and is a member of various prestigious editorial boards, such as Oxford University Commonwealth Law Journal, the Indian Journal of Law and Technology, the Socio-Legal Review, and the International Journal of Communications Law and Policy. He has been published in numerous reputed journals and magazines, such as the Journal of Indian Law and Society, the Socio-Legal Review, the Economic and Political Weekly, and the Indian Journal of Constitutional Law, to name just a few. Professor Krishna Swami is also the co-founder of the not-for-profit research trust, the Center for Law and Policy Research. Today, Professor Krishna Swami is one of the people who play a pivotal role in sculpting the landscape of legal education in India. And it is only fitting that he's delivering our welcome address for today's lecture in memory of Professor Madhav Menon. It is our absolute privilege, sir, that you are here with all of us today. Over to you.
Thank you, Tahira, and good afternoon, everyone. Tahira, a long and very gracious introduction. Thank you for that. And I hope that, you know, when you list out all these good things at such length that we can actually live up to them. May I also thank the Akhil Bhartiya Adhivakta Parishad for organizing this series. Professor Menon was a teacher of mine and founded the institution I was educated at. And so it's always an honor to be here and speak and do this welcome address for the series in his name. And Nachiket and Shomendu have put in a lot of effort to have me here. Thank you. And I know that Mr. Mukul Rohatgi, who follows me, is the main act. And I have a small part here, which is to reflect a little bit on what Professor Menon's contribution to legal education and to the history of institution building in India is like. And so what I'm going to do is I'll just take two small vignettes, two small stories about Professor Menon that I think to be significant, and I hope convey a sense of what the challenge of institution building in this country might be. So the first an important thing is that Professor Menon was not necessarily the first legal academic to come up with the idea of a national law school. The first proposal was by a professor from the Jawaharlal Nehru University, who was an associate professor. I'm talking about the first proposal in print, was by Rehmatullah Khan in the Journal of the Indian Law Institute, where he suggested that Indian legal education was too technocratic, too legal, too doctrinal, and it was very important that legal education in India become a little more social, scientific, and humanistic. This small 5-page article, still available on the internet, thanks to the Journal of Indian Law Institute being freely open access to any among you, this proposal for a national school of law, ironically, Professor Rehmatullah Khan said the first national school of law should be at JNU. And he thought that, why was that important? Because law would be nested in the social sciences. That was his motivation. And he thought that if we made law an interdisciplinary degree, then we would see a great revolution in Indian legal education. So that is the early published piece. Professor Bakshi responds and others join in the conversation. This idea gestates for a certain period. A lot of people are responding to the idea. The UGC is engaged with the process. But then Professor Menon comes along at some stage. And what is striking about Professor Menon in this context is he comes in and he embraces an idea which was originally not necessarily attached to his name. He thinks this is a good idea. It's a viable idea for legal education reform in India. And he just goes for it. And what he does is that, given all the complexities of navigating Indian institutions, he manages very successfully at institutionalizing the idea. And what I take and what I learn from this short history, it's a short potted history of the National Law School, is that, so often in life, the ideas that we run with need not be our own, so long as we have the grace and humility to know that these are important ideas, they contribute to legal education and to nation building. We can go out and make this happen. And that's exactly what Professor Menon did in the late 1980s. NLS was set up in 1989, and 32 years later, we have a very we have come with 23 NLUs around the country. The second idea that I want to pick up, and this is what I'll conclude with, is how do you think about institution building? And most people would imagine that institution building, get a big bucket of money, get a large grant of land, then recruit the most fancy academics you can get, and then recruit the very best of students that you can get, and then you get a great institution in an academic institution sense. But notice how when Professor Menon set up the National Law School in 1989, none of this was present. Right? He did not get large grants of land. It got a modest grant. Initially, the National Law School started in a very small establishment as a part of the Central College in Bangalore. Second, just make sure that you get a lot of money. He didn't get a lot of money. The Bar Council of India contributed partially. The government of Karnataka contributed partially. Some senior lawyers contributed. But it was not enough. But he still managed to get off the ground. He never had the best students necessarily when he got started, nor did he have the most exceptional faculty. But how did he produce such exceptional outcomes under these constraints? And I think what we learn here is that having the capacity to imagine good systems, doing small things consistently over a period of time generates above average, sometimes exceptional outcomes. That if you just saw the founding conditions of the university was simply not would simply not have happened. It reminds me of Dr. Ambedkar's quote on constitutional morality, which is often quoted, and I think sometimes mistakenly. And what Dr. Ambedkar is focused on is how do you institutionalize democracy in a society that may not have a history of democracy? You focus on the small things. You do the small things well, you do them consistently, and democracy takes root. So what Dr. Ambedkar and the founders of the Indian Constitution managed to do with constitutional democracy in India, Dr. Menon managed to do with the National Law School. He created a new way of running an institution by doing things modestly but consistently. And I just want to say this because more often than not, we think of figures like Professor Menon as grand actors, you know, doing great, grand things. And I want to really today just emphasize the small, paying attention to the details, getting the details right again and again and again. It seems like boring work, but it's what builds great institutions. So let me stop here and hand over back to Tahira and look forward to listening to Mr. Rohitji.
I can't hear her. Tahira, we can't hear you.
You might be muted. Yeah.
I'm so sorry. Professor Krishnaswamy, thank you so much for the insights into the development of legal education in India and exceptional contribution. It is now my pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker for today's lecture, Senior Advocate and former Attorney General for India, Mr. Mukul Rohatgi. Not only is Mr. Rohatgi one of the busiest, if not the very busiest senior advocates in our country today, but is also a leader of the bar and a mentor and guide to a great number of younger members of the bar. Mr. Rohatgi graduated from Government Law College, Mumbai in 1978. After his graduation, he started practice under Honorable Justice Y.K. Sabharwal, who later went on to become the Chief Justice of India. The stories of Rohatgi's minded discipline, passion, and his ability to handle a huge number of matters in a day, even as a young advocate, are well known to all of us. As a young lawyer, he would leave his house every morning by 7 a.m. and aim to complete all the pending work he had with the matters on which he assisted Justice Sabharwal by 7 p.m., after which he would start working on his own cases. His discipline and commitment are much the same today. As we all know, he works a 12-hour day and on all weekends. His single-minded dedication, which has no doubt been the key element behind his phenomenal success, is a great inspiration to all of us at the Junior Bar. In 1993, Mr. Rohatgi was designated a senior counsel by the Honorable High Court of Delhi. In 1999, he was appointed as an additional Solicitor General. In 2014, he went on to become the 14th Attorney General for India. During his tenure as Attorney General, Mr. Rohatgi has argued path-breaking cases such as the Triple Talaq case, the Aadhaar case, the Jharkhand Assembly case, the Manipur fake encounter case, the Best Bakery case, the Zahira Sheikh case, and the list goes on and on. Amongst all his extraordinary abilities, be it his razor-sharp mind, his impeccable court craft, or his ability not to be daunted by the bad facts of a case, it is widely agreed by his contemporaries, briefing advocates, and his juniors that his greatest ability, which makes him the most sought-after lawyer in private practice today, is to cut to the heart of a matter within minutes, simplify the most complex legal issues, identify areas of conflict, and provide a practical solution. Despite his phenomenal success, Mr. Rohatgi's large-heartedness, avuncular nature, and generosity of spirit make him one of the most well-loved seniors of the bar today. The most recent example of his generosity, which is only one of very many, is his generous contribution in the fight against COVID-19, including funding the conversion of an old bus into a mobile testing laboratory. We thank you, sir, and we welcome you today to share your thoughts with us on the topic, the journey of the Honorable Supreme Court from 1950 till now. If there are any questions on the topic, I request all of you to send them in and they will be addressed by Mr. Rohatgi at the end of the lecture. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much. First of all, thank you for Adivakta Parishad for choosing me to give this lecture and on a very, very important issue. I am also thankful to the Vice Chancellor of the National Law School at Bangalore, which is one of the most premier institutions. Regretfully, the times when I did my law, there were no such institutions. And we used to do a 3-year BA and a 3-year law course, not as intense as a 5-year law course. And the premier institution out of all the law schools, I am told, is Bangalore. And it is heartening to note that the Vice Chancellor is a young man who graduated only 22 years ago, makes me feel much older. And usually one remembers Vice Chancellors as white-haired people who may be dotty and tottering, but not so. We have a flamboyant young man. So full marks to the Vice Chancellor for keeping the flag flying high. Now, as far as his mentor, Mr. Menon, is concerned, though I didn't have the opportunity of being taught by him or attending any other lecture, but I did meet him once in a while at some functions. He always reminded me of being a visionary, soft-spoken, never resting on his laurels. And he had an uncanny resemblance and manner of speaking with one of our excellent Chief Justices, Justice Venkat Chalaya, who also happens to come from Bangalore. Before I go into this detailed and important subject, I only wish to tell you that my late father, apart from being a judge of the Delhi High Court for 13 odd years, was also a part-time lecturer in the Delhi University from 1947 till 1972. And I think one of his last students would have been Justice Sikri, who retired from the Supreme Court a year ago. So I have in my family lecturers, lawyers. My father-in-law was a prominent lawyer in the Supreme Court. My other relatives and both my sons are also lawyers. And so is my wife, but she's not practicing currently. So now I go into this subject of the path of the Constitution for the last 70 years since independence, or since India became a republic in 1950. I may tell you in advance that I know that a large number of people who are listening to this lecture are lawyers. Some may be young, some may be experienced. But there would be other people who are non-lawyers who also want to know how the Supreme Court and the Constitution have worked themselves. Have they acquitted themselves in the last 70 years or not? So I will try and keep this talk as less legalese as is possible, but the non-lawyers may pardon me if it becomes a little legalistic at times. So first of all, in introduction, in a very brief, in a compact manner, the Supreme Court of India was born in the year 1950 when our Constitution came into being and was adopted, namely soon after independence. Prior to the Supreme Court, the highest court in India was the Federal Court. The Federal Court was established under a pre-independence law, which was called the Government of India Act 1935, when India was only a dominion. And as a matter of coincidence, the last Chief Justice, if I'm not mistaken, of the Federal Court was Sir Maurice Dwyer. And those who are familiar with Delhi University would know Maurice Nagar, like Kamala Nagar, on the outskirts of the university, and Dwyer Hall, which was named after Sir Maurice Dwyer. He happened to be the Vice Chancellor of the university and the Chief Justice of the highest court at the same time, which was possible in those days, but not possible now. A judge of the Supreme Court or the High Court cannot hold any other post whatsoever. After the Supreme Court came into being, the Federal Court was abolished, and the role of the Privy Council in England, which would also hear appeals from Indian courts, was also abolished. And the Supreme Court became the final court. In fact, I am corrected by my son that Sir Maurice Dwyer was in fact the first Chief Justice of the Federal Court. The life of the Federal Court was only a few years before the Supreme Court came into being. The Supreme Court was meant to be a small cohesive court. It started with the Chief Justice and seven judges. Later on, the strength has gone on being increased from time to time. And today, we have some 34 judges in the Supreme Court who sit in benches of 2, 3 and 5 generally. I must tell you that originally the Supreme Court was meant only to be a constitutional court. It was meant to be a court which would decide grave issues of the Constitution, the rights of citizens guaranteed under the Constitution, their conflict with state and state authorities and state laws, something on the pattern of the US Supreme Court, where 9 judges of the court all sit together in one bench and rule upon conflicts of laws of different states of America with the central law in America or the federal law. But unfortunately, the Supreme Court, and as I will deal with later, has taken upon itself too much of a burden and has become virtually an appellate court. But I must tell you that the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court is very wide. It has several jurisdictions. One, it hears appeals against different high courts. It hears appeals against tribunals. It is entitled to hear an appeal against any authority whatsoever. Secondly, it has advisory jurisdiction to advise the President of India. President of India actually means the central government. Thirdly, it has a jurisdiction which can be directly approached by any citizen without going to any lower court, much less the High Court. And that is a jurisdiction which is very jealously guarded by the Supreme Court, where an individual can move the Supreme Court for enforcement of fundamental rights of the individual. Fundamental rights, as commonly called, are right of freedom of speech, right to reside anywhere in India, right to travel in India, right to carry on business in India, right of life and liberty in India. All these rights are fundamental rights, apart from religious rights, right to religion and other rights, rights of minorities. Of course, all these rights are subject to reasonable limitations. None of these rights are absolute. That was how the Supreme Court was envisaged as a court to deal with the subjects which I have indicated. I must also tell you how judges are appointed to the Supreme Court. By and large, judges from the High Court are elevated, or it's kind of like a promotion to the Supreme Court from High Court judges. though there is a procedure for appointment directly of a lawyer or a jurist or even an academician who may not be a lawyer directly to the Supreme Court, but experience has shown that in the last 70 odd years, not more than 7 or 8 such direct appointments have been made. Though I must say, to the credit of the current government, about 4 or 5 appointments directly were made from the bar of the Supreme Court to the bench in the Supreme Court. And this has added a lot of talent and merit to the Supreme Court. A judge of the Supreme Court retires at the age of 65. A judge of the High Court retires at the age of 62. But I must tell you one thing with which I don't agree, and I will have something to say later, that the appointments to the Supreme Court from the High Court are generally done on seniority, which is that usually chief justices of different high courts are elevated to the Supreme Court and not purely merit-oriented. So by this method, whoever by quirk of circumstance, by seniority, becomes the senior most judge of the Supreme Court, by and large, he goes to the Supreme Court. And in the last, I think, 20, 30 years, there have been only 7 or 8 judges from the High Court who have gone to the Supreme Court who were not Chief Justices. Now, before we go further, I have divided this lecture decade-wise. So the first decade is 1950 to 60, then second 60 to 70, and so on, till the last decade of 2010 to 2020. And that would show the path the Supreme Court has gone upon and dealt with a large number of important cases, and I will touch briefly upon some of those cases. I also must tell you that as opposed to certain other jurisdictions, our system of common law, which we have inherited from the British, which we still follow, is precedent-based. What does it mean? It means that if the Supreme Court, in a bench of, say, 5 judges, has decided upon a particular issue, then the same shall be followed by all benches of coordinate strength of 5 judges or lower strength. Nobody will have a right to deviate. That is the basis of precedent or precedent value. If a lower bench strength finds or doubts a larger bench strength judgment, it can make a reference, though it is rare and not very common, to a larger bench requesting the Chief Justice to constitute a bench of, say, 7 judges, which can review the view taken by 5 judges. But this is not the norm. This is not very, very usual, but it does happen. And the Supreme Court has the right to reverse its own view. I will only point out that this precedent-based system is not followed in a country, say, like France, which does not follow common law. They are not bound by precedent, though they may respect the precedent. One more word on the Constitution. The Constitution is the supreme law of the land. All laws framed by Parliament must not fall foul of the Constitution. So by what do you mean by all laws? All laws mean, say, laws relating to succession, laws relating to property, laws relating to mortgage, laws relating to contract, laws relating to goods, laws relating to checks, laws relating to insolvency. So all these laws must follow the spirit of the Constitution and must not breach the principles of the Constitution. Say, for example, one of the most important principles of the Constitution is that equals will be treated equally. Or in other words, unequals will not be treated equally. This is the right of equality enshrined in the Constitution. So if there is a law which discriminates against this constitutional premise or edifice, then the law can be declared as invalid, even though it may have been passed by a majority in parliament, which is the supreme legislative body. So this is how all laws have to be in sync with the constitution. And the role of the Supreme Court is to test the laws when a challenge is mounted, that they breach fundamental rights or right of equality, which is also a fundamental right, and test it against the constitution. I must also tell you that the constitution was framed by a body called the Constituent Assembly, which commenced its work prior to independence. And it went through the constitution, the draft constitution. Many debates were held in the Constituent Assembly, which was headed by Dr. Rajendra Prasad, the first president of India. And Dr. Ambedkar was the chief and main architect of the constitution. For every lawyer, I suggest, when you read the constitution and you have to read various articles, you must first read how the article in its final form came about and how it was in the draft form. Where was it taken from? Maybe the American constitution, maybe the Irish constitution. Our constitution is an amalgam of principles taken from different constitutions. And Dr. Ambedkar was the real architect who did not spare any effort in bringing out a cohesive constitution. So the debates of the Constituent Assembly will tell you what went on in the minds of judges, minds of the assembly members when they framed the constitution. One more point I will dwell now and then later. Judges of the High Court and the Supreme Court under the constitution have to be appointed by the President of India. And as I said earlier, President means the government of the day, because all actions of the government are ceremoniously taken in the name of the President. The President does not exercise his independent will, but he is guided by the will of the government, except in certain special circumstances. But unfortunately, by a judgment delivered recently in the last 5 years, the court has not gone on with this principle that the government will appoint judges and the government will consult the Chief Justice. Unfortunately, consultation has been rendered to be concurrence of the Chief Justice, which was not meant to be. And now the role vests only in the Chief Justice to appoint judges. I will deal with this issue a little later. The role of the Supreme Court also can be described as the role of a sentinel or a guard, always on the lookout to uphold the constitution. It has been called sentinel quevi, namely a sentinel on the lookout. The job of the court is also to dispense justice fearlessly without bothering to see race, color, creed, or religion. It is meant to keep the other two wings of the body politic in check, namely the legislature and the government. So there are three wings: judiciary, legislature, and executive. They are meant to be in sync and not to encroach upon the fields of the other, and that is the role of the constitution. So now we come to the first decade. The first decade saw Pandit Nehru bring a host of laws to parliament for approval, namely agrarian reforms. Pandit Nehru found that there were a large number of zamindars who owned vast tracts of land, vast villages, in fact, and the zamindari had to be abolished because the normal poor person or the peasant or the farmer was suffering under the cruel rule of the zamindars who were a law unto themselves. So zamindaris were abolished. Now those were obviously challenged by the zamindars, because at that time there was a fundamental right to property. That fundamental right was done away in the year 1979. So the 50s saw a struggle between the zamindars talking about their fundamental right to property and the government talking about abolition of these zamindari estates across India. So immediately Pandit Nehru amended the constitution. There is a power of amendment in the constitution. The extent of amendment, the width of amendment, can you amend the constitution so that it doesn't look like the constitution anymore? All these things will come a little later. So the first amendment to the constitution in 1951, before the ink was dry on the constitution, was creation of what is called the ninth schedule to the constitution. The constitution consists of various articles and eight schedules. So a ninth schedule was added. What was the purpose of the ninth schedule? That if a law is put by parliament or with parliament's approval in the ninth schedule, ninth schedule was like an almirah. If it is put in that almirah, then that law became immune from challenge, which was otherwise the right of the Supreme Court to entertain a challenge based on infraction of fundamental rights. That challenge was no longer available. So that was the first inroad in the power of the Supreme Court to strike down a law on the basis of what I have told you 5 minutes ago. And I can tell you that the ninth schedule has been used and abused by various governments in the last 70 years. And today, there are hundreds, if not thousands, of laws in that schedule, including laws passed by different states. It is not only limited to central acts, it is to state acts also. So that was an almirah against which there was a steel door through which the arrow of the court could not pierce. So that was the first thing. Second, the Supreme Court has jealously guarded as the most important fundamental right of a citizen, being the right of freedom of speech in a democracy. So freedom of speech, the right to live, the right to life, right to have liberty and not be jailed according to unjust laws or unjust procedures, are some of our basic fundamental rights which the Supreme Court has always strived to uphold. So in every decade, one or two cases of upholding fundamental rights has always been done by the Supreme Court. So one such judgment is a famous judgment called Ramesh Thapar, who was an editor. Then came the issue whether Parliament could amend the Constitution so as to do away or abridge fundamental rights. This is something which has been agitating the minds of the court on various issues, on various times, at various times, in several decades, including the current decade. And I will briefly touch upon this history. So a judgment came called Shankari Prasad, where the Supreme Court said that Parliament can amend the law, provided it follows the procedure of amendment, which meant that the fundamental rights could be amended, abridged, or deleted. This issue again attracted the attention of the Supreme Court in the next decade, that is 60 to 70. So a bench of 11 judges was constituted. That case is called Golaknath's case. That was the name of the gentleman. In Golaknath, the Supreme Court said, taking an opposite view of the earlier case, that fundamental rights cannot be amended even though there is a procedure or power of amendment. But something curious I must tell you, the judgment in Golaknath of 11 judges is not a unanimous judgment. It is a judgment of a razor-thin majority of 6 judges to 5. 5 took an opposite view, 6 took an opposite view. And since our system is based on precedent and number of heads, so to say, 6 outnumber 5. So 6 outnumbered 5 and took the view contrary to the view of the earlier case. So a complete turnabout. Now, this happened in 1967. So we've had 2 contrary views, 1950s, 1960s. But as luck would have it, this was not the end of this controversy. Then came the third decade of the 70s. And I must tell you, this was the stormiest decade, the most turbulent decade of the Supreme Court, of the Constitution, of the country, because emergency and its prior period and aftermath all happened during this period. So what happened in this decade? This was a decade to start with, the decade of nationalization. By this time, Mrs. Gandhi was the Prime Minister and a powerful Prime Minister. She came with a brute majority in the March 71 elections. So in this period, 2 sectors were nationalized to start with. One was all banks, 14 banks were nationalized. Their assets were taken over. They have now become private government banks like State Bank of India and Punjab National Bank. The second thing which was nationalized was all the coal mines in the country. I must tell you, India is the 5th largest producer of coal, and it is the 5th largest reserves of coal in the world. And coal is the basic fuel in India even today. So coal mines were nationalized, which were in private hands. And the third thing which was deleted was privy purses of all the erstwhile princes who joined the Federation of India. All these were challenged because, again, property was a fundamental right. So bank nationalization was in a case called R.C. Cooper. The nationalization was annulled by the Supreme Court. The annulment of privy purses was also annulled by the Supreme Court. So then started a contest between government and parliament on one hand, because the government's will was parliament's will. And on the other hand, the judiciary and the individuals who moved the judiciary. So as I told you, the 11 judges case, 6-5, went up before a larger bench again to decide whether parliament can abridge, delete, or dilute fundamental rights. It went to a bench of 13 judges. That's the largest bench strength ever from that day till today. That is called Keshwanand Bharti's case. There were 13 judges in this case. Again, all the 13 judges were not unanimous. It is in fact a legal conundrum to find out the complete unanimity on various points of various judges. Some judges agreed with other judges on point A but not point B, on point C but not point D. And in fact, it is intriguing to note that the bench, after the judgment, decided to pen down the operative part of the judgment, which could be signed by all the 13 judges unanimously. That attempt failed, and only 7 could sign what was meant for 13. So this is a legal conundrum, and I suggest lawyers to do research on this, and in fact read the article of late Shri Adhyaru Jina, a senior lawyer of the Supreme Court, who was a junior lawyer of Mr. Palkiwala in this case, and he will tell you in his article what really went on. But I want to now raise an issue for our lawyer public, or the lawyers who are listening. 6-5 in Golaknath reversed an earlier view, and again 7-6 in Keshananda Bharti, the decision is 7-6, again a razor thin. So the point which I am raising for your consideration is, take a case where a 7-6 bench of 13 reverses the unanimous view of 9 judges. Is it appropriate that 7-6 should reverse a unanimous view of 9? This issue was raised in Golaknath itself by Shri Settlewart, the first Attorney General for India. But I am raising this question again because it is happening every day. It is happening even today. So this is a question which I submit to my lawyer brethren to examine. Now, Keshananda Bharti's case held that Parliament does not have absolute power to amend the Constitution or to take away basic fundamental rights. It propounded a theory, and it was argued by a person no less than the legal genius, Shri Nani Palkiwala. The court held that there is a core of the Constitution, or a basic structure or pillars of the Constitution. So the basic pillars and the structures cannot be altered so as to make the Constitution completely unrecognizable. For example, democracy could not be done away with. Federalism could not be done away with. Rule of law could not be done away with. We could not do away with our system of parliamentary democracy with the Prime Minister at the head to be changed to an American presidential system. So these were the basic things which the court held Parliament has no power. Even though Parliament represents the will of the people, even though there is the power of amendment, and theoretically, an amendment can mean deletion also. Now, this happened in 1973. It set the tone for further conflict. Mrs. Gandhi had come by then, as I told you, with a great majority in 1971. She was incensed by this verdict. So the first thing which was done was a super session of 3 judges of the Supreme Court who were in line to become the Chief Justice, and a junior judge, namely Shri A.N. Ray, was appointed as the Chief Justice. This is the first time 3 senior judges were superseded after the Constitution came into force, and where seniority of the Chief Justice was a given rule. So that's the first thing, and those 3 judges resigned. And I may tell you the names of those 3 judges was Hegde, Shellett, and Grover. So Ray became the Chief Justice. Thereafter, Indira Gandhi's election was challenged by Mr. Raj Narayan in the Allahabad High Court. The Allahabad High Court gave a verdict in June 1975. A single judge, one judge sitting on the bench, and I must say a very courageous judge, and his name I remember was Justice Jagmohan Lal Sinha. He annulled the election of Mrs. Gandhi on corrupt practices. That's the power which this High Court has. under the Representation of People's Act to annul an election which is fought on corrupt practices or which is fought in the name of religion, etc. Immediately, Mrs. Gandhi could not take that defeat. She could not take that affront. And immediately, emergency was declared in India on June 26, 1975. And I think it was the darkest day for the democracy and for the life of this nation. It was declared and signed by the then president, Shri Fakhruddin Ali Ahmad, who soon died after that, maybe that shock which caused that heart attack on of signing the death of democracy. Immediately after emergency was declared, thousands of people were arrested and put in jails. A presidential order was passed that during emergency, people don't have a right to challenge their detention. Or even if they were deprived of their life, to challenge it in a court of law. Those rights of challenge before the High Court and the Supreme Court were suspended. As if fundamental rights could be suspended on that premise. Challenges were laid to such actions in different high courts in the country. Several high courts were courageous and took the view that fundamental rights and right of a challenge to the higher courts to enforce fundamental rights cannot be suspended. A person cannot be detained without authority of law, and he will have a right to challenge, and the government will have to show how the detention is justified. The courageous stance of the high courts was brought to the Supreme Court by this government. And in a very infamous case called Additional District Magistrate Jabalpur versus Shivkant Shukla, the Supreme Court, on a bench strength of 5 judges, by a judgment of 4-1, please mark this, by a judgment of 4-1, it reversed the stand of the courageous high courts. It played into the hands of the government and said that yes, fundamental rights will remain suspended. It was only one judge who had the courage to dissent. And that judge became immortal in the legends of judicial history. None other than late Justice Hansraj Khanna. And here I must tell you before I go further, that in the Keshananda largest case, as I told you, of 13 judges, it is he who tilted the balance of 7-6 to hold that Parliament cannot abrogate the Constitution by removal of fundamental rights. So this judge, the singular judge, in 2 years from 73 to 76, he had the courage not once but twice to uphold the Constitution and say that the government or parliament cannot ride roughshod on these rights only because of a majoritarian view. I must also tell you that an article appeared after this judgment of the Supreme Court, which was a very infamous judgment, in the New York Times, which said that hope is fading in India, hope about democracy is fading. Emergency and its excesses were writ large, and it paid glowing tributes to late Justice Hansraj Khanna and said, if something must be done to uphold the democracy, the first thing should be to build a monument in honor of this judge. And as luck would have it, Justice Khanna, slated to be the next Chief Justice, was again superseded like the past, and he resigned. And a judge called Justice Hamidullah Beg was then appointed as the Chief Justice. And I must tell you, after the emergency was lifted in 1977, the majority judgment, which was this infamous judgment, was completely discarded. And the dissenting judgment of the lone judge ultimately became the law, and nobody followed the judgment of these four judges, which had held that the rights of citizens can be trampled upon. Then came the era of the Janta government. And just as a point of fact, the Janta government deleted the fundamental right to property. So from that day, 1979 till today, there is no fundamental right to property. There is a constitutional right to property, but not of the highest pedestal, like freedom of speech, freedom of life, freedom of liberty, freedom to reside, freedom to move. Then comes the fourth decade. In the fourth decade, the decade of 1980, there are two important things which happened. One, the doctrine of PILs, public interest litigation, was coined. So no formal petitions were required. A letter postcard could be sent to the Chief Justice about an atrocity, and the court could take it up on the basis of a letter postcard. Court relaxed the rule as to who can move the court. It relaxed the rule of a formal filing of a petition. It relaxed the rule of filing court fees to be affixed on the petition. And this credit must go to Justice Bhagwati, who was the pioneer of public interest litigation. So from then on till today, hundreds and thousands of causes of the poor and the downtrodden, of environment, of so many other fields has been taken up by the Supreme Court. So the first of the cases was a case of bonded labor called Bandhua Bukti Morcha. It was brought to the notice of the court by Swami Agnivesh, who is a social worker and carries on his social work even today. But one interesting anecdote I will tell you of that decade. It is commonly called the first judge's case. I am not getting involved in the details because they may be a little boring. I must also tell you that there was a rivalry between two judges of the Supreme Court, which is now an open secret. And I will tell you how it is an open secret. Justice Chandrachud, father of current Justice Chandrachud, was senior to Justice Bhagwati. But Justice Bhagwati became Chief Justice of a High Court earlier. But he was younger to Justice Chandrachud. But Justice Chandrachud came to the Supreme Court earlier, followed by Justice Bhagwati a year later. Justice Bhagwati always thought that since he was senior and the Chief Justice, but otherwise younger, he should have been brought first. And had he come first, he would have had a large tenure of more than 8 years as Chief Justice. A usual tenure is between 6 months to 3 years. But Justice Chandrachud had a tenure of more than 7 years, and Justice Bhagwati's tenure was curtailed to about a year or so. He could never swallow this, and this kind of rivalry went on between the Chief Justice and his senior most judge. And this rivalry resulted in one case where Justice Bhagwati's bench ordered the Chief Justice to file an affidavit in a case about his personal knowledge about something about his duties of as a judge. It was not a personal case of property. It was a case which related to appointment of judges. And the Chief Justice Chandrachud had to file an affidavit, much to his discomfiture and much to add to this controversy which was going on between the two judges. This was not all. Justice Bhagwati in the judgment referred to the affidavit, quote unquote, as delightfully vague. So he got back at that affidavit. This is how the controversy went on. And I must tell you, just as to bring you up, current Justice Chandrachud, after 45 years, in the privacy judgment of 9 judges, had the courage to overrule his father's view in the infamous Jabalpur case, which I have told you. And he has written in the judgment after 45 years that maybe his father thought that his judgment in that case was completely wrong. And the last coincidence, Justice Chandrachud's son, that is the third generation now, his son is a lawyer and an author in Mumbai. And he has written a full chapter on the conflict and the controversy between his grandfather, Chief Justice Chandrachud, and Justice Bhagwati, quoting extensively from a foreign author called Ged Boyce, who interviewed many judges and wrote a book. So that decade also saw, as I said, public interest, right of the downtrodden, right of pavement dwellers in Olga Telesis case, right of a clean environment. Then came the next decade, the decade of 90s to 2000. Public interest went on further and further. There were cases of public employment relating to backwards scheduled castes. I don't want to tell you about those details, they're rather technical. Then came an important case called Vishakha. What should be done in cases of sexual harassment in workplaces, even though there was no law? So the Supreme Court coined a system by which it would frame the rules in the absence of a law passed by Parliament, and those rules will be applicable till a law replaces it in Parliament. So those were rules framed by the Supreme Court. And it has done a yeoman service in various workplaces, etc. The sixth decade is the decade of 2000 to 2010. In this decade, a very important judgment was delivered by my erstwhile senior, late Sri Y.K. Sabharwal, who headed a 9-judge bench in a case called Cohello, where they said for the first time, after about 60 years, that the 9th schedule to the Constitution, which was framed in 1951, which I told you by the example of Almira, that a law placed in that Almira of immunity can still be challenged and the immunity is not absolute. It is a path-breaking judgment in favor of fundamental rights, in favor of the rights of citizens, so as to pierce the veil or pierce the steel door which had been kept by Parliament so as to check attacks on invalidity. In that decade and this decade, the last decade, there have been many PILs on environment, on the right to breathe, right to live. And right to live means right to live with dignity. And that is why you have so many cases on environment. But I must tell you where the Supreme Court went wrong and lost its way in this decade. In its zeal to uphold the environment, in its zeal to correct government orders or government inactions, it dealt a serious blow to the economy of this nation. And I will tell you 3 cases. One is cancelling all coal allocations of mines across the country. Lakhs of crores of foreign investment, lakhs of crores of equipment, infrastructure and lakhs of jobs were thrown overboard when the court set aside and cancelled all the allocations of coal blocks and coal mines for a period of, say, 10 years because the government did not follow the law correctly. According to me, it should have seen the economic impact. It is imperative for a court to do that and then mold the relief. The same thing happened in what is called the 2G case. All 2G licenses of telecom were set aside by the Supreme Court. Foreign investment by Ethi Salat, by so many other players, has gone down the drain. And again, there is a great loss to the economy. The third such case is cancelling all iron ore mines in the states of Goa and Karnataka, so that in the last maybe 5 or 7 years, the mining activity has still not been able to come up. It is still suffering. People have lost their livelihoods. People have lost their business. International contracts have been cancelled. Foreign exchange has been lost because a lot of iron ore is being exported. So the court should have seen the economic impact before it rendered these judgments. This is where I submit that the Supreme Court lost its way. One very important judgment delivered by a 9-judge bench is the judgment on privacy. The Supreme Court has held that the right of privacy, that is the right to remain anonymous, the right not to come in the glare, the right not to be known to others, that right inheres in the fundamental rights guaranteed by the Constitution. Then in the recent years, we have had good judgments, path-breaking judgments, striking down triple talaq, striking down Article 377 relating to gay rights, upholding the rights of the transgenders. All these are positive inroads or positive paths which have been cleared by the Supreme Court. So there have been ups, there have been downs. So now, having completed up to the latest and the last decade, what is the way forward? What should the court do? I think a couple of things must be remedied for the Supreme Court to come back on the correct path, some of which I will dwell now in a few minutes. One, I forgot to mention in the last decade a very important case called the NJAC case, where the Supreme Court annulled a constitutional provision by which the absolute right of appointment of judges, which the Supreme Court had taken upon itself, was sought to be diluted by Parliament by introducing views of the government through the Law Minister and some views through independent legal experts to be brought in as a collegium with the leader of opposition, as a wholesome whole to decide and take the views of different shades to decide a person should be appointed or not. The Supreme Court annulled it by saying that this will affect the independence of judiciary and retain the right and its sole right to appoint judges, which I submit is contrary to the Constitution. So what is the way forward? According to me, the Supreme Court should graciously give up its right to be the sole body to appoint judges. In no country in the world, judges solely appoint themselves. So that should be the first thing. There should be fresh blood, fresh insight, fresh views, so as to find out who are good judges. That's the first thing. Second, appointments to the Supreme Court should be on merit, where seniority may play a part, but not that seniority will outweigh merit. In the last 20 years, mostly only chief justices of high courts are appointed to the Supreme Court, only because of seniority. And very few judges go on merit and merit alone. Third, to tackle pendency of cases, the Supreme Court must have time management. It must not allow arguments to go on ad nauseum for days on end, as is the current system. Lawyers also must understand, it's not a blame to the court only. The lawyers are primarily guilty of going on with arguments and dilly-dallying and taking adjournments. Artificial intelligence must also be used to club all kinds of cases together, so one case can decide the fate of 1,000 who may have been filed at different points of times. Now, we come to what we are facing today. We are facing today a system which is plagued by COVID. We are unable to go to court. So what should be done? Lawyers are unable to go to court. The original way of arguing in court is all gone. We have now to adapt ourselves to a new system. And I have, for one, tried to adapt myself in the last 2 weeks, 2 months. I have argued several cases on video conferencing, VC for short. But this is a new and a nascent technology. It has many problems. Sometimes the connection is not good. The internet strength is not good. Audio is not good. Video is not clear. There are 10 lawyers. Some people are muting their microphones so that there is less of disturbance. Sometimes we are not heard. All this is going on. So I think the step forward for the next few months is to make this system as perfect as possible. And I'm glad that the Supreme Court is constantly working at it. Justice Chandrachud is the head of the e-committee. So every court must work, including the high courts and the lower court, to make this system good so that people are able to work from home, because rendering of justice or justice delivery cannot be stopped even for a day. It can become diluted, it can become imperfect, but it can't stop. Now, I'm glad to tell you that I have come to know that in the next week, more benches in the Supreme Court are going to sit. More cases will be disposed of. And I think the future is to do these cases more and more. And one more great advantage it will have, that young lawyers will be able to argue their cases. Young lawyers will get a chance, because I must tell you, as a senior lawyer, we have got accustomed to the fact that we interrupt the other side when the case is going on in a court of law, and more so a junior is unable to interrupt a senior. But when video conferencing is going on, and if I am arguing against a junior, and when junior is arguing, my mic has been muted, and I have no right to interrupt somebody. So this will build up the bar also. And I think this is a good way forward. And I hope that the Supreme Court ultimately goes back on the path and restates the law and restates its role, what it was meant to do in the Constitution, and not merely become an appellate court and go down the path of trying to correct every injustice or to wipe every tear from every eye or indulge in landlord-tenant cases or cases dealing with, bouncing of checks or cases dealing with recovery of a house, cases dealing with insolvency. Such kind of cases were never really meant to be decided by the Supreme Court. So you require a restatement of the law and a restatement of your values. And I must tell you, not a joke, a real exchange of views, which is very amusing. The Supreme Court every Monday decides 60 cases per bench. 60 cases per bench in a space of 3 to 4 hours. So broadly, it's about 2 minutes a case. If you take half a minute to pick up a file and half a minute to drop a file, and sometimes to dictate a short order. So you have to put your best in 1 minute, and that is where the expertise comes of an experienced lawyer. So there was one case, a very witty lawyer, Mr. Daftri, was arguing before the Supreme Court the case related to whether a particular practice was gambling or betting. And there have been cases where it has been held that Rummy as is a game of chance and is not betting. So he was arguing on the difference of gambling. So the judge remarked, Mr. Dostri, you seem to know a lot about gambling and betting. Are you accustomed to it? Pat came the reply that when I do 60 or 50 cases spread over 1 minute each, it is nothing but gambling and lottery. So the bench laughed and gave him relief. This is how I would like to end this lecture or a talk. I don't want it to be taken as a lecture. I want it to be taken only as how I have perceived this journey for the last 40 years. What I have seen, I have indicated to you, and how the court has gone through and the Constitution. And the Constitution has been amended more than 100 times. I would end by saying I'm very thankful to the listeners also and the organizers for giving me this time, and I have taken a lot of time, I take it, in telling you what I feel in my humble way, how the court and the Constitution have gone till today, traveled till today, and how they should go in future. Thank you very much. Thank you, and good day and good afternoon to all of you.
Thank you so much, sir, for that absolutely brilliant conspectus of the landmark judgments of the last 70 years. It has given us so much food for thought, especially on questions like whether judgments with a razor-thin majority should be able to overrule unanimous judgments of, albeit a slightly smaller bench. It is so rare for all of us to get such a multidimensional insight into the history of the Supreme Court. Your anecdotes, you know, are going to give us so much context when we reread our landmark judgments again. There are a lot of questions which have come in, so I'll just pick a few of them, sir, if time permits.
Yeah.
So, according to you, which is the single judgment which, in your view, has shaped the constitutional law of our country?
The judgment I referred to, the 13 judge bench judgment, which held that fundamental rights or basic structure of the Constitution cannot be altered by Parliament. That is that Keshananda Bharti's case, and I think that is the most path-breaking judgment in creating a concept of the basic structure or basic pillars of the Constitution.
Thank you so much, sir. So another interesting question that has come in is, despite the right to privacy having been enunciated by the Supreme Court in the Puttuswamy judgment, do you feel that the citizens of India really have a right to privacy?
Look, I personally feel that an absolute right of privacy is a myth. Privacy actually means to be left alone, be anonymous. Nobody should know that you existed. Nobody should know what you're doing, what you're eating, where you're going. But in today's time, with much electronic advancement and the fact that everybody today virtually has a credit card, everybody has a mobile phone, and by these things, you can be tracked anywhere in the world where you may be. If you use a mobile phone based in India, but you use it in Afghanistan, it can be found in 1 minute that you are based in Afghanistan in that area. If you use your credit card in Iceland, in 1 minute you get a beep on the phone that your credit card has been used in Iceland. And the man who's giving you the beep obviously knows. So it's not correct to say in today's times that you can have an absolute right to privacy. Of course, people should have a right to know that nobody is poking in to your house or to see what you're doing, but it cannot be absolute.
Thank you, sir, for your honest answer on that. There's another interesting question. In recent times, if you could change the outcome of any one case, which would it be?
It would be, I would put two cases. One, the recent NJAC case, where the Supreme Court has retained the absolute power of appointment of judges, made it into a club of judges where nobody else can enter and give views as to how judges or which judges should be appointed. That is the first case which according to me should be overruled. The second case, of course, is a 50-year-old case, the infamous case of Jabalpur, which I cited, where Justice Khanna was the sole dissenting judge.
Right, sir. Thank you. Another question which is often debated is whether, do you think it would be feasible to have regional benches of the Supreme Court?
I, for one, am against regional benches of the Supreme Court. And my experience has shown that the Supreme Court has to be a cohesive court. It must speak in one voice, even though there are several benches. Unfortunately, we have some 14, 15 benches, and every bench is churning out judgments every day. And sometimes it is possible that you get completely contradictory judgments delivered on the same day by two different benches on the same point, one not knowing the other. And then you have to go about getting them corrected by, as I said, reference to larger benches and all that. That's a very, very difficult process. So if you're going to have benches, then this problem will be compounded and confounded further. Now, with advancement of VC, advancement of electronic filing, where people can argue from their different places, where they need not come to Delhi and spend money, then there is no need to have these benches, and VC will demolish all the arguments in favor of or in favor of different benches.
Thank you, sir. Sir, I think the last question that we'll have to take now, as we're running out of time, is whether you feel the system of virtual courts that has started, with the unfortunate advent of COVID, do you think it is something that is feasible for the future? For instance, would it be possible, God willing, if we can all come back to court one day?
I think it is feasible. I think we should use this crisis to our benefit, because this has shown that a lot of people can latch on from different areas, remote areas, not spend money in coming to Delhi, not spend money in filing thousands of papers, in being able to argue from wherever they are. Even a senior lawyer may be engaged who may be elsewhere, and a lot of cost and time is saved in this process. Now, how should we do it? If we go back to physical courts after 3 months, we should never give this up. We should hone it to perfection. And according to me, the Supreme Court and the High Courts can set aside a bit of time every week to video conferencing, where certain cases can be dealt with, giving parties a chance. Say, you may start with 2 hours every week, where the court will devote its time to video conferencing. It can be increased to 3 hours or twice a week. And this way we can, not only in courts, we can extend it to arbitrations. We can extend it to hearings before tribunals. It can go all across the nation. It can go on interaction between, apart from courts and tribunals, interaction between a citizen and a government office. You can have a video conferencing. Why is the need for everybody to come to the capital to attend to the ministry in the capital of the state or capital of the center and hang around and go every day? All this can be done by intelligence, which will save a lot of time, save a lot of expense, save a lot of anguish. I'm all for it.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for that dynamic answer. There are a couple of questions which have come in for Professor Krishnaswamy. Professor, do you feel
Taira, sorry. Yes. I have to go off. All the best.
Thank you.
You can carry on. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for your valuable time.
Bye.
Thank you.
Professor, there are a couple of questions which have come in on the future of legal education in India. Do you feel that the days of the three-year course are numbered now, and will it only be five-year programs going forward? And what do you feel are which is the better system in your view?
So,
the idea that the three-year course is the days of the three-year course are numbered has been going on for what, two or three decades, and we still have three-year courses. So I think that that was premature then and it's premature now. In most parts of the world, legal education is a postgraduate degree. That is, you do a first degree in something and then you double up with a law degree. What I'd say is that the three-year degree is awaiting a reinvention. Something happened in legal education in 1989 with the creation of the five-year degree. I think we are now waiting to see and some institutional initiative and reform on the three-year program. And if that happens, I think the three-year program will revitalize. Today, the number of young graduates who want to pursue a law career across different graduate streams has multiplied. We're just waiting for an institution to grab this opportunity and bring all this talent into the legal profession. A revitalized, redesigned three-year degree will do just that.
Thank you, sir. That was great. The last question, which you know, a couple of people have asked, is how are the students of NLS doing in the lockdown? Have you been able to implement video lectures with the students, and has that been going seamlessly?
Seamlessly would be putting it too far. You know that access to bandwidth and devices is mixed among different student groups. But as a university, we have put in place a robust system. We transitioned very quickly to online education, and we have held up through the term. So far, so good. Mr. Rohitki talked about how the court must take to online courts very seriously. I think universities like ours should take to online education very seriously. And this crisis has pushed us in this direction, maybe much faster than we would have otherwise, but I think that it's here to stay. And you will see, at least from the National Law School, a very big initiative on online legal education going into July 2020. So you can expect some much wider range of courses and a much more engaging way of doing distance learning.
Thank you, sir. We hope that will continue in the future as well. Now, unfortunately, we are out of time, so we can't take any further questions. But I would like to thank you for sparing your valuable time to be with us all today. And I would also like to thank all the viewers for their overwhelming participation. We've got so many comments of appreciation for both the speakers. Mr. Mukherjee, can I ask you to please give the vote of thanks?
Thank you, ma'am. There's a very famous quote which says that if you can't fly, then you should run. If you can't run, then you should crawl. And if you can't crawl, you should never stop moving. I think this motto guides the Akhil Bharatiya Adhivakta Parishad, that we've been running our hearts out. And every step that we've taken as a team, it's been one to remember. And we are nearing a month from where we started. It was on the 20th of April. And from there on, to have witnessed firsthand as to the overwhelming response that we've had, the love that we've received, and the consistent growth in our audience, it's been really overwhelming and it's really humbling for all of us. And to present quality lectures from personalities who've mastered the art and who we all look up to, I think that's extremely satisfying for all of us. And today we've successfully completed 14 lectures, 12 in our previous series and two, and I think there are more to come. There are two more certainly planned out and they will be coming in the weeks to follow. The Honorable Supreme Court yesterday added another feather to its cap and in its journey with the introduction and presentation of its e-filing system. And we wish that these endeavors really make access to justice easier. And I would like to congratulate Tahira ma'am on her cracking the Advocate on Record examination and emerging on top and inspiring us all aspirants and young lawyers to aim for nothing but the best. And you've moderated today's session with such sheer finesse and class. Thank you, ma'am. To Mukul sir, he's left, but we thank him for spending this hugely enriching 1 hour with us and how elaborately he broke up the Supreme Court's journey into 5 decades in very simple language. And I think this is one video which is relevant for even a law student to the retired octogenarian, and in very simple language for all of us to understand. To Dr. Sudhir Krishna Swami, sir, thank you for your welcome address. It has been your maiden appearance on our platform, and surely it will be remembered for times to come. I also had a privilege to be at the NUJS campus when you were a faculty there, and I must say that the students miss you a lot, sir, at the campus. On behalf of the Akhil Bharatiya Adhivakta Parishad, our sincere regards and thanks to Tahira ma'am, to Mr. Mukul Rotki, and Dr. Krishna Swami. We look forward to continue the series and see you back for the next lecture in a week's time with another eminent personality. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone. Stay safe and keep well. And we'll be catching the next lecture soon.